It's snowing outside, so today we can talk about driving in it.
In today's video, we're just not talking about snow. It's just that if I film snow, you guys are going to more likely click on the video. So now that you're here, we're going to talk about driving in colder climates. First of all, before we start, before you even get into the car, and we're going to warm it up. Now, because my truck's parked inside, I don't have to run the motor for that long. I'm just running it just long enough to get the fluids going. So it's only about 30 seconds to a minute. So I actually use my remote starter quite a bit, actually, even no matter what time of year it is, because I'm trying to get the fluids going. Even though I do install remote starters and I recommend them, I actually don't recommend people over-idle their vehicles because you're going to waste a lot of fuel and you're probably going to cause unnecessary wear because you need to actually get the motor running under load to shoot the oil up throughout the motor. But the initial startup is the oil is really low and it's very thick. So we want to get it moving a bit so we can just drive away and not waste time.
So, see the truck's running already and we're ready to go. Go on anymore. Today's video is about a two-wheel drive truck or a vehicle that we're leaving in two-wheel drive with the rear wheels driving in. So if you're driving a vehicle like this, I do recommend that you put some weight in the back, 150 to 200 pounds. That'll give you more traction when you're trying to go from a dead stop. Okay, so we're about to get onto the road. We just have to wait for this truck to get out of our way. Today's video, before we get into the actual demo part of it, is we're really just covering common sense. When I talk about common sense, it's things that I noticed in the lower mainland, Vancouver, people lose it all when you start to see this white stuff on the ground. Apparently, they just don't know how to drive. When you drive in the snow, go with the flow of traffic, sure, but reduce your speed, especially if you have all-season tires. Actually, it doesn't really matter what kind of tires you have. If it's winter tires, if it's all-terrain tires that have the snowflake on it, really good all seasons, you should reduce your speed and increase your following distance. So if you look at this truck up here, if we're on a downhill slope, we don't want to be really next to it because in situations around here, if the hill's really aggressive, it could be icy, we might increase our stopping distance by quite a bit. That is the first thing. So remember, following distance and reduce your speed. Now, it's hard for me to film at night, but what we're going to talk about is also your lights. I see a lot of people when it's pitch black out and it's really starting to come down, people think if they turn on their high beams that they're going to see more. No, don't do that. Rely on your fog lights if you have them and your low beams. You want to cut underneath the snow. By turning on your high beams, it just reflects off the snow and it just blinds you. And I've seen people on the highway drive with their high beams on only and slow down to a crawl. They're going like 50 kilometers an hour, 40 kilometers an hour, when they could be easily doing 70 at least. But because they can't see that far in front of them because they're turning on their high beams. Before starting your journey, make sure to clear off your mirrors and also your headlights. Here's a downside to LED headlights if you guys run them. You'll see here, I've been running the truck all day. We have a bunch of snow on in front of it. These LEDs don't get that hot. That is the main advantage of having halogens. As they get warm, they will melt away the lens. The LEDs are not doing that. So these are things you have to keep in mind if you've been driving for a while. You might want to pull over and make sure that they're clear. Before starting your vehicle, you see that Jeep in front of us. It's been out in the snow for a bit. It's not a big deal. But if it's been snowing for a long time, you really want to clear a bunch of the snow off your vehicle. We'll go over that in another video, but just as a quick tip, don't drive the brush into the paint because you're going to probably end up giving it light scratches. But you want to clear off a lot of the snow because as you're driving, as the cabin heats up and the hood heats up, that snow might start flying off the vehicle. And if those things have turned into like hard chunks of ice, it might hurt, it might hit another vehicle. So we want to be courteous to other drivers by removing as much snow off your car so it doesn't go flying into them. Another thing that we want to focus on is, again, visibility. I'm not sure if you guys can tell, I'm not turning my wipers right now so you can see. You can see that the water is beading off the windshield. We have Rain-X on the windshield and we also run very good wiper blades. That way we can clear the snow. You also want to make sure you knock your wipe blades before if your car is parked outside, that way they can operate. I've seen some people, there's a bunch of snow on the front and they just turn their wiper blades on, they're gonna burn out the motor that way. So we really need to focus on visibility before we even talk about driving etiquette or driving skills. Today is a great day to go over the basics of driving in the snow. Now, if you're going to practice, what you're gonna have to do is you're gonna have to find a deserted area or private property like I'm on. That way you can kind of
get a feel for the vehicle, because driving in the snow, you know how I always talk about my videos and I'm all about driver feel? Well, driving in the snow is extremely important because the vehicle is really going to communicate with you on what's happening. We're going to go over braking, and we're going to go over taking off from a stop, and we're maybe going to discuss a little bit about counter steering. We're not going to get too heavy into that because you guys need to crawl before you can walk on this one. So let's just go over the bare basics to driving safe in the snow. On the vehicle that I'm using in today's video, it does have a full set of winter tires and they are studded. So this is why we have the ability to brake and have a good launch every single time. So let's go over braking right now. For braking, I recommend, well, any movement in a vehicle in winter driving, I recommend being very gentle with the vehicle, not doing anything abrupt. Especially in a vehicle that doesn't have ABS, you don't want to just slam on the brakes and tense up your arms, because you're basically just going to turn your vehicle into a hockey puck. So we're gonna show the vehicle using ABS, which I prefer to use because modern ABS is very good, and we get a very good stopping distance, and we can still steer as well because it doesn't lock up the wheels. And we're also gonna do a threshold brake as well, just to show you that with proper tires, it still will brake pretty well. So we saw the ABS engage a little bit there, then that's doing a full brake application. So there our brake application was a little bit less than a full application. That was what we call threshold braking. In a vehicle like this, you don't necessarily have to do that. You see, we didn't brake as quickly, but it did feel better because we're not engaging the ABS. Honestly, on modern vehicles, I would just do a full brake application and let the electronics do all the work for you. For those of you that don't have ABS, you're probably going to want to pump the brakes or do threshold braking so you don't lock it up. If you feel the wheels lock up, you're going to have to let go. Years ago, I did a video on two-wheel drive versus four-wheel drive on this exact same hill, and we were talking about starting from a stop, because on an incline, a lot of people might have difficulties on it because the vehicle cannot get traction. I made the suggestion to start in second gear. I still stand by that, but it created this uproar on the internet saying, no, it only limits the vehicle up to second gear, and then other people say it does start in second. Well, both sides are actually correct. It depends on the vehicle. We have a 2001 Montana. If I put it into second, it will start in first, and it will only go up to second. However, in my pickup, I'll show you the manual later, it will start in second. Now, I was unclear of how I was explaining it though. I said it was reducing wheel spin. The reason why I was saying reducing wheel spin, at 100 RPMs or 1000 RPMs in first gear and second gear, yes, first gear does rotate slower at 1000 RPMs. My reasoning though was, a vehicle that is losing traction is probably spinning faster than a wheel that actually has traction and is moving with the ground. So just before I start the demonstration with the truck, let's just talk about when you're walking on a snowy incline. Now, when we're walking on a snowy incline, we don't run up the hill, because why? We're applying a lot of force and we're going to slip. Kind of the same idea when you have a lot of torque at the wheels. So second gear reduces the torque. Like you are as a person, you walk up the hill, what do you tend to do? Well, you tend to walk up really dainty and light. This way, we have lots of traction. We're applying less force though, but we make up the hill a lot easier. Here, me trying to sprint up the hill, what happens? I slip and I lose traction, I break the friction point. Here, me walking very dainty, less force, less torque, I make up the hill very easily and very controlled. So that's the same idea with the vehicle starting in second. If the vehicle has the ability to start in second, we're going to reduce the wheel torque, thus the vehicle has traction. So technically, in that instance, it is spinning slower. But I get what everyone's saying is, if you have traction, yes, first gear is a slower rotation. But because we're not braking traction, it's a slower rotation. Kind of makes sense? I know, it's a little bit confusing. Let's just do it with the vehicle now. Before we do the demo, let's open up and read the owner's manual for the truck. This is where my second gear technique comes in, because certain vehicles, like the truck that we're using in the video, allow us to only select second. So let's read this. This position gives you more power but lower fuel economy. You can use second on hills. It can help control your speed as you go down a hill, which is using engine braking, steep mountain roads, but then you would also want to use the brakes off and on. If you may manually select second in a light-duty automatic transmission, which is our Chevy Silverado 1500, the transmission will drive in second gear. You may use this feature for reducing the speed of the rear wheels when you're trying to start your vehicle from a stop on slippery road surfaces. Now, what I want you, don't mind the wording, because I know a lot of people are getting upset about the wording saying, oh, well, second gear has slower rotation at this RPM versus second. Yes, you're right. Watch the video and listen to the engine. Listen to the engine as it actually spools up a bit before the wheel starts. So, you know, a lot of people are thinking in terms of a manual transmission is very simple. It's possible that when the vehicle is put into second, the transmission programming may be altered a bit, and that's why it starts the way it does. So listen to the engine and watch the wheels, and we'll do it back to back so you can see how the truck behaves a little bit differently. So on this part, we're trying to stop the truck and we're trying to engage the G80 locker right now. So there's a little bit of a hump in front. We're gonna stop on it, and it's kind of act like a speed bump basically. And we're gonna just use driver first gear, and we're just gonna negotiate this part, and then you can see what the truck does. Okay, this time we're gonna do the exact same thing. Yes, there's a little bit less snow this time, but this is what I have to work with. But we're gonna do the exact same thing, and we're gonna do it in second gear this time. Okay, for this test, I'm gonna be a little bit unfair because I don't have the most slippery conditions and the truck is grabbing a lot. I am gonna be a bit aggressive with the throttle just to show you the difference in torque being applied and how the truck can break loose. If we had a lot more snow or ice, I wouldn't have to give it that much throttle, because if we were driving in actual road conditions, we would be very light with it. But let's just see if we can get the tires to break loose different ways. Now I'm gonna start the truck in second, and I'm gonna give it a good amount of throttle, and we're gonna try our best to break traction with the rear tires. The first time wasn't hard at all. That was in drive, that was me giving it a quick blip on the throttle. Now let's put it in drive again, and let's be really easy on the throttle this time. We didn't have as much wheel slip that time because we weren't applying as much torque. Now let's just do it very slowly, and we should have similar results to what we had in drive. Another note about the second gear thing, let's think about this in a high horsepower situation. Have you guys noticed on certain car review magazines or some of the channels on here, some of these really high horsepower cars, they'll start the cars in second, like a Hellcat. And have you noticed that the Hellcat has a better time starting in second? Because in first, it's breaking traction like crazy. So if we were to measure the car going from a dead stop, second gear gives you more traction because it just doesn't have so much torque that it just wants to break the tires loose. Now, in conditions like this, it wants to break, this truck only has like 330 pound-feet of torque, if that. Since it's modified, I think stock this truck is 300 pound-feet of torque. This thing will break loose, no problem, especially when I have no weight in the back. So being very gradual, very slight on the throttle, and applying less torque using second gear from the start really helps me get more control, especially when I have to contend with uphill sections. For our collision avoidance, you have to keep in mind that our speeds were very low. We are probably still under 20 kilometers an hour, and we're dealing with more of a slushy condition than we are icy. But you can see that I was doing the same speed, same amount of throttle. I just did a really aggressive turn in, which would typically happen if you're having a late reaction time when something just happens in front of you. And the truck still handled well, but you see with a smooth bike, if I was aware of looking way far ahead and I was aware of I had to make a lane change, the second time was a lot more gradual. And the truck didn't move over as aggressively. Now, if we were dealing with icy conditions, that aggressive turnover, the truck might have just plowed straight. So be really gentle with your controls is really the key.
So you can see we're in side streets now that are not cleared at all. So we're just dealing with a lot of slush and fresh snow, and we have a hard time touching the pavement, and everyone's driving slow, which is good. And these are situations where if you're not careful, you might find yourself you have to counter steer. And counter steer basically where the truck's going too much one way, which is called oversteer. So we have to compensate by, if the truck's oversteering a lot to the right, we're actually steering the truck left to keep it on point. Now, this again, you want to do in the parking lot, but there might be a situation where you come in and you're giving it too much throttle, especially rear-wheel drive car, and maybe you're just trying to go straight and the vehicle just starts to go off to the side. Like, we might be going straight in the vehicle, the rear tires are breaking traction, so it just starts to go off to the side. So we have to counter steer into it. We're not intentionally trying to put it into a snow drift or anything, but it's very likely that it will happen in slippery situations when you're at speed or if you're applying throttle. So that's why you want to be careful. Like right here, see the truck just wants to kind of go off to the side, but we have a lot of grip, so we don't have to counter steer that much, and we're not going into with a ton of speed. We're just trying to get going. But these are things that you have to get familiar with feel, just in case, you know, an oh crap situation happens and you have to steer the vehicle. So right here, I don't really want to counter steer, but I had to. And I'm not applying a lot of throttle here. Remember, today we have no way in the back. I guess I was kind of lazy. I was expecting to dump the snow. We just had the snow tires on, so the truck does want to break loose a little bit compared to what it usually does. Here, people always complain that I had the wheels turned in my last video, and here's a situation why I had to turn, simulating this situation. I'm on a little bit of a hill, here's traffic, I have to turn the wheel, I'm in drive. See, it takes the truck a little bit of time to get going, but I have to turn the wheel to get onto the road. Yes, I could keep the wheel straight and go into the second lane, but I would rather aim towards the middle. I would always wait, though, for there to be no traffic, though. I'm not going to even attempt to get in the middle of traffic because they're going to have a harder time braking because of the conditions. Even though this is a main road, it's salted, and I'm a lot slower out of the gate because I have to deal with an uphill situation, very slight, but I'm a lot slower than if I had dry pavement. That's why in that video, I simulated me turning the wheels, because one, on that ramp, there's a wall right in front of you, so you kind of have to turn it to avoid it. And this is a situation that I dealt with on a daily basis. I used to, when I had my Thunderbird, it was the worst. The Thunderbird, when we first drove it, it had all season tires, open diff, and no weight in the back. The next season after, we put a big sub box in the back for weight, and we had winter tires, still open diff though, and it negotiated that a lot better. Because the Thunderbird, with the open diff and the all season tires, it did not want to move off of that. Straight wheels or not, it didn't want to. So that's why in that previous video from a few years ago, you saw me have the wheels turn, because I was simulating this exact situation. It's rare you come across a situation, yes, you should have your wheels straight, but sometimes you have to have the wheels turned a bit. Okay, so now we're on the highway. It's a totally different situation. It's still snowing, but the highway gets traveled a lot, and it's salted on a regular basis because that's where the city would concentrate. Now, if you look at the cars in front of us, here's a huge tip that I like what everyone's doing today. Everyone everyone has their parking lights on. Now I'm going to move back into the right lane because I should be cruising the right lane because I'm going really slow. But you can see the cars that have their parking lights on, which is pretty much all of them, are a lot more visible. So that's another tip I want to give you guys. Even if it's daylight out, this is like, it's 1:47, it's the middle of the afternoon, but we have low visibility. Turn on your parking lights. You don't have to turn on your headlights, but turn on your parking lights so people behind you can see your vehicle a lot easier.
Now it's the end of the day, and here's another thing you guys have to consider when you're driving in snow. Right now I have the vehicle in gear. I have it in one. Flat land, the truck's not moving. Because we're in a little bit of snow right now. So let's get going, applying some throttle. Now, why I want to bring up this time of the day, you can see that the road has been traveled quite a bit. There's tracks, and it's all fine. This was slush. Problem is, when the sun goes down, the temperature starts to drop, and if no one has salted the road, you'll start to feel that it feels very bumpy as you're driving around. Bumpy road means that slush is now turning into ice, which means it's very slippery, and if you have four-wheel drive, it's going to help you a lot to move. Everyone's going to have a hard time stopping. So if you're hearing a lot of crunching and the road just feels like you're on a dirt gravel road or a logging truck road, that's a good indication that you are in an icy area, which means it's going to take you a very long time to stop. It's going to be very hard to move up hills if you don't have four-wheel drive or good tires. And you just have to be very light on the controls. So being very aware of your terrain is going to make sure that you get home safely. Well guys, hopefully these tips helped you for your winter driving. Go out there, practice, get a feel for your vehicle, and make sure that you're set up properly to handle these conditions. To see what else I'm up to, make sure to check out my Instagram, AnthonyJ350, and my Facebook page. And also check out our website at www.gofasthavefun.ca. Yeah.